and welcome to the White Swan. Since you're from Pittsburgh, where were you in 1960 when Bill Mazeroski hits the home run against the Yankees?
I was at the game, sitting in right field, right behind Roberto Clemente.
Oh my gosh.
I couldn't believe, you know, a lot of people will say, I was at that game. But in those days, you had to send in for your tickets. I got mine in the mail as soon as I could. And I was up in my room, and my mom got the mail and said, your World Series tickets are here. Oh, which game? Number 7. I thought, oh, God, it's not going to go 7.
Yeah, yeah.
The Yankees were, you know, the mighty Yankees.
Yeah.
Went 7, and what a game.
So what did you do after it went over the left field stand? Did you go?
Oh, yeah. Jumping up and down and like that.
So
Oakland was a madhouse.
Yeah.
Every Saturday night, the family would get together. My grandfather, grandmother, uncles, aunts, and whatever, and have like a little party, because it was before television.
Mm-hmm.
And they'd sing the songs of the day, the songs on the hit parade. And I'd be down there amongst them, and you know, I'd be singing along with them and everything. And then I'd go to bed and hear them carrying on downstairs.
So this was all a cappella?
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that was our local neighborhood group. I sang bass with the Montereys, and I did a few leads. And Al Noble was a famous disc jockey from Pittsburgh. And he would have a battle of the groups like every Friday night at the Lodge Potenza in Mount Washington in Pittsburgh. And I was there with the Montereys, and I sang a lead, Sympathy by the Cadillacs. And Joe Rock was there with his group, the Crescents. And after we came off stage, he approached me and said, you know, you sing lead real nice. He said, you're the bass singer, but you sing leads too. How would you like to join my group as the lead singer?
Wow.
And they had already been traveling around to the hops, and they were established, had clothes, you know, stuff like that.
Must have been a big thrill.
Well, yeah, it was.
You're 14 years old.
I think it was maybe 15.
So what did Mom and say, or Dad and say about this, did launch you kind of on a new career here?
Oh, well, you know, they were happy. At least I was, and every night we rehearsed, so I had somewhere to go, and I wasn't, then there was Smitty's pool room also, you know. So.
The group consists of Joe Rock and...
he was our manager.
Manager.
And he wrote the lyrics, and I wrote the music to most of our songs. The Crescents had signed with ABC Paramount, and Don Costa was the A&R man. A year went by, and they never called us to go into the studio to record. So, three of the guys in the group, they said, "I'm going to quit. I'm, you know, we're never going to record anything." So they quit. And our guitar player Jack Taylor was also a good singer. He sang bass. So I took Jack and Wally Lester, who was the second tenor with the Crescents. And
is that when Janet Vogel became part of it?
Yes, and I brought Janet Vogel and Joe Verschuren into the group. And so we had myself, Jack Taylor, Wally Lester, Janet Vogel, and Joe Verschuren sang baritone. They were both from Carrick, from my high school.
Oh, okay. Janet being added to that in that time period, having a female, was that common?
Well, I admired the Platters, and we actually did it because Wally Lester was the top tenor in the Crescents, and those notes are starting to get a little bit tough. But with Janet being the female, the notes were very easy for her to sing the top part to in the background. And we dropped Wally to second tenor, which he was happy about because he could now make all the notes. Joe Versharon was a natural baritone. And Jack Taylor sang bass, so we put it together real nice.
A young record promoter named Joe Rock met a young singer named Jimmy Beaumont. Together, the duo would make rock and roll history with Joe's writing talents and Jimmy's voice. And in 1959, the Skyliners would help shape the sound of Pittsburgh.
The story goes that Joe Rock, while sitting in his car between stoplights, wrote a lyric titled, "Since I Don't Have You," about the girl who had just left him. Jimmy wrote the music the next night. Someone brought in a tape recorder and a roughed out an a cappella demo was done. Janet, thinking the tape was turned off, kept riffing at the end, weaving up to an incredible high C finale.
That's right. That was Janet's composition at the end.
Yeah.
We were set to end it, but we didn't know just how we were going to end it. And songs, we were going to fade it out, actually, because a lot of the songs of that day, they used the fade-out ending. And then when Janet added her obligato part, you know, at the end, and hit that high note, you know, we thought we really had something then. Well, we had Calico Records, a local Pittsburgh label, was just starting off. I think they had one artist. And they held auditions. They were looking for, you know, people to put on the record label. And so we went there and we performed Since I Don't Have You for them. And they had Lenny Martin, who was a brilliant arranger. And after we sang Since I Don't Have You, he stood up, he said, "That we'll take that group right there." So we signed with Calico Records, and I asked him, always wanted to record with violins. And I said, "Lenny, do you think we could have violins on this arrangement?" And he said, "Oh, yes." He said, I was thinking along those lines also. We were singing it in the key of F. And he said, can you sing it just one half step higher in F sharp? Because F sharp is a brilliant key for violins." And I was 18 years old, I thought I could do anything, so I said, "Sure." So we did. Actually, Alan Freed was in New York at the time. He actually kicked it off. And also Jocko Henderson was in Harlem. He was the big black R&B DJ of the time. Actually, it went number one R&B before, you know, Alan Freed. But he kept playing it, and I think our first show was at the Apollo. So that was fun.
So you walk into the Apollo, which is known for black acts principally, and there's mm-hmm. your five white. What was the reaction?
Well, before I go into that, I had heard that they had, if you weren't good enough, they had a clown with a hook, the big hook, who would come out and grab you and pull you off stage. I thought, "Oh my God, you better be good now. This is one of the hardest audiences in the world." So we walked on stage, and there was a murmuring, if you know what I'm talking about,
yeah.
all through the audience. "Oh, no, pointing at you." The band started, and it got really quiet. It was like, hear a pin drop. And I thought, "Well, you better be good now, because the clown's in the wings with that hook." Little did I know that it was on amateur night that he did that, Wednesday night. This was a Monday. So it was really quiet. And then at the end, when I started singing My Use, most of the guys in the audience were singing with me. And when Janet hit her high notes, most of the women were singing with her. And then when she hit that high, the girls hit that high note with her, standing ovation.
Young at that age, you're 17, 18 years old, and you're touring the country now with Caravan of Stars, among other things.
Yeah, Dick Clark Caravan.
Mm-hmm. Ladies and gentlemen, the Skyliners.
The Roots. The Roots. This is where it's at now. Just wonderful people. They're the best.
Every time it rains, it rains. Pennies from heaven. Don't you know we try to save pennies from heaven? You'll find your fortunes falling all over town. Make sure that your umbrella,
make sure your umbrella's upside.
Baby, don't you know?
Ready for a package of sunshine and flowers. If you want the things you love, you must have showers.
And we were doing the Alan Freed shows at the Brooklyn Fox, 10 days, 5 shows a day. When you're that young, though, you don't realize it.
That's but pretty heady stuff.
Well, yeah. And sold out every show. Crowds outside around the block were, you know, waiting to get in for the next show. Policemen on horses, you know, trying to control the crowds and everything. So, and then after we did the first Alan Freed show, we did go on tour with the Caravan of Stars, Dick Clark's, and Paul Anka. Who else is on that? The Coasters, Annette, Dwayne Eddy, so many others. For our second song, This I Swear, we formed our style from the R&B groups of the time and the jazz groups, the Four Freshmen, High Lows, Lambert Hendricks and Ross. And so we combined the R&B and jazz. And on This I Swear, during the bridge part, the middle of the song, I was determined I was going to make that jazz, as much jazz as I could, so that another group would have a heck of a time trying to cover it. So.
At some point, how do you take a deep breath?
Well, actually, the Beatles had us take a deep breath because 1964, we disbanded for a little while. I pursued a single career with Colpix Records, Columbia Pictures Records, and of course, during that period, up until 1970 or so, it was mostly English groups that were getting the airplay. And also, thank God for Motown, you know, because they kept the R&B hits going, our style of music. And we got together with the original group in 1970, when the rock and roll revivals, they called them. And boy, that was really a smash hit. The first one we did, two nights at the Academy of Music in New York, in the Village. Gus Gossert was a DJ then, and sold out both nights. And then Richard Nader, he saw how that was working, and then he had his at the Madison Square Garden. 20,000 people showed up, and so the music took off again.
Would you please welcome a group that flew all the way in from their hometown, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, to be with our anniversary celebration tonight. Here are the Skyliners!
Oh.
since I don't have you, it's been played several times in movies and that, and is that a great callback for you to keep you kind of on the road today? Is that?
Well, yes, that and also the doo-wop specials on the PBS stations all over the country. Henry DeLuca and T.J. Lubinsky, two promoters from Pittsburgh, took the idea of bringing the doo-wop groups back and having a show. We're going to do just one show and see what happened. And WQED, the big wig, said that'll never happen. That music's, that's passe. It's old. No one's going to. Somebody talked him into it, and so we did the first one in 1999, and it's still playing.
Yeah, oh, I see it all the time.
It's been the biggest moneymaker in 1999 in 1 year that WQED ever had. So
there's a movie out, since I don't have you, on the life of Janet Vogel. You had a chance to see that, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
What did you think of the movie?
It was well done, but it was very dark. That's the impression that I got. And they premiered it in Pittsburgh. They tried it at different film festivals and stuff, but never could raise enough money to get the initial, coverage over the country. So. But it was true, it was very true. No, she was always, whatever you guys think, whatever you want to do, I'm with you. She was that way. Good kid.
You're here today, the White Swan, which, if you've seen some of the other posters, when I walk out tonight after the performance, what is it that you'd want me to remember about Jimmy Beaumont and...
We're all lead singers, so that makes the background that much more powerful. And a great drummer, Mark Groom, he's married to Donna Groom. Frank Zuri is our second tenor. Nick Pochak is our bass baritone singer. And I think I did say Mark Groom is our drummer. Mm-hmm. And we work with great musicians, you know, wherever we go. It's usually one of three different groups that we work with around the country. We've been very fortunate, and I'm just thankful and blessed.
Well, we're blessed to have you here, Jimmy, and thank you very much. Chuck will really appreciate this opportunity.
All right, Chuck. Thanks for having us.